From Pacifica, this is Democracy Now!
I'm asking the FCC to reclassify internet service under Title II of a law known as the Telecommunications Act. In plain English, I'm asking them to recognize that for most Americans, the internet has become an essential part of everyday communication and everyday life. The FCC is an independent agency, and ultimately this decision is theirs alone. But the public has already commented nearly 4 million times.
After much anticipation, the chair of the Federal Communications Commission has unveiled what he calls, quote, the strongest open internet protections ever proposed by the agency. We'll look at this victory for net neutrality, then to the case of Sami Alarian.
And I was put in solitary confinement 23 hours a day, and sometimes for weeks, 24 hours a day. I wasn't allowed even to see my attorneys, which it comes in. I wasn't allowed to call my family. For 6 months, I was not allowed to make a single phone call.
The prominent Palestinian activist and Florida professor, Sami Alarian, was deported from the United States this week. In one of the most controversial prosecutions of the post-9/11 era, Alarian was accused of ties to a militant group, but a Florida jury failed to return a single guilty verdict on any of the 17 charges against him. Since 2003, Alarian has spent 5.5 years in jail and many more under house arrest. He'll join us from Turkey in a broadcast exclusive, and we'll speak to his daughter, Layla. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The leaders of Germany and France are in Russia for talks on ending the renewed violence in eastern Ukraine and restoring a September ceasefire. German Chancellor Angela Merkel and French President François Hollande are meeting with Russian President Vladimir Putin in Moscow to discuss an initiative partially based on Kremlin proposals. Merkel spoke earlier today ahead of her trip to Russia.
It is a question of peace and preserving the European peace order. It is a question of free self-determination of the people as part of this European peace order, and we are doing what we believe to be our duty at this time, namely trying to do everything in our power to end the bloodshed.
Chancellor Merkel and President Hollande met with Ukrainian President Petro Poroshenko in Kiev Thursday. Dismissing rebel demands to account for recent territorial gains, Poroshenko called for a return to the ceasefire terms agreed to in September.
The Minsk plan is very simple. Immediate ceasefire, releasing all the hostages, closing the border or renew the international recognized border on Ukrainian, withdrawal of all the foreign troops and from the Ukrainian territory, launching very important process of the political regulation by the election on the municipal election, local election, and the Ukrainian legislation in the territory of Donetsk and Lugansk.
On Thursday, the Ukraine government said it had arrested a senior military officer on charges of spying for Russia, raising new concerns about the infiltration of Ukraine forces. The developments come as the Obama administration considers sending military aid to the Ukrainian government in Kiev in what would be a major escalation of U.S. involvement. In meetings with Ukrainian leaders Thursday, Secretary of State John Kerry accused Russia of aggression in eastern Ukraine and said he expects a decision on U.S. military aid soon.
We talked about the largest threat that Ukraine faces today, and that is Russia's continued aggression in the east. Now, there's no other way to call it. We're not seeking a conflict with Russia. No one is.
The president is reviewing all of his options. Among those options, obviously, is the possibility of providing defensive assistance to Ukraine. And those discussions are going on. The president will make his decision, I'm confident, soon.
The weaponry under consideration includes anti-tank missiles, battlefield radars, and reconnaissance drones. Speaking in Washington, White House Press Secretary Josh Earnest acknowledged internal concerns that sending weapons could worsen the crisis.
One of the concerns that we have about providing military assistance is it does contain the possibility of actually expanding bloodshed. And that's actually what we're trying to avoid. the whole reason that we are trying to encourage both sides to sit down and hammer out a diplomatic agreement is to end the bloodshed and end the escalating conflict in that country.
On Thursday, the Kremlin said the U.S. arming of Ukraine would threaten Russian security. German Chancellor Merkel has opposed calls to send military aid to the Ukraine government in Kiev. At a meeting in Belgium Thursday, NATO defense ministers signed off on a plan to establish a network of command centers in Eastern Europe and a large rapid reaction force to counter Russia. NATO Secretary General Jens Stoltenberg said the measures mark the alliance's biggest reinforcement of collective defense since the end of the Cold War.
We decided on the immediate establishment of the first six multinational command and control units in Bulgaria, Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, Poland, and Romania. If a crisis arises, they will ensure that national and NATO forces from across the alliance are able to act as one from the start. They will make rapid deployment easier, support planning for collective defense, and help coordinate training and exercises.
Jordan has intensified airstrikes on the Islamic State following the immolation of a captured Jordanian fighter pilot in Syria. Jordan says dozens of fighter jets struck ISIS sites on Thursday in Syria and for the first time in Iraq. Jordan's vowed to expand its role in the U.S.-led anti-ISIS coalition following the pilot's death. Jordan's announcement followed reports that the United Arab Emirates, a key coalition member, suspended its airstrikes in December over concerns for its pilot's safety. Meanwhile, scores of people were killed in and around the Syrian capital of Damascus Thursday when rebels fired a barrage of rockets into several neighborhoods and government warplanes bombed opposition-held areas. Greece's new finance minister has wrapped up his inaugural tour of Europe following the Syriza Party's historic election victory last month. Yanis Varoufakis visited European countries as part of his government's push to roll back austerity and renegotiate Greece's international bailout. On Thursday, the finance minister was met with a chilly reception in Germany, Greece's biggest creditor and the leading European backer of its austerity. At a news conference with German counterparts, Varoufakis made a direct appeal to German taxpayers.
My message to the average German hardworking taxpayer is that you have given us too much money in the last 5 years, not too little. Unfortunately, this was not an act of solidarity, even though it was portrayed as one, to the Greek people. 90% of that money never came to Greece. It was a cynical transfer of banking losses, initially onto the shoulders of the Greeks. Everybody knew that the shoulders of the Greeks were not strong enough to sustain that weight, and that would spill over to you. We're coming here to begin for the first time a dialogue about how to minimize the cost of the Greek crisis to the average, not only Greek, but also German, Slovak, Finn, Spaniard, Portuguese, and so on and so forth, so as not to mention every member state of the Eurozone.
German Economy Minister Sigmund Gabriel countered Varoufakis by saying Greece must be held responsible for its previous commitments.
Every country has the right to democratically elect a new government. And of course, every government has the right to determine a new policy course, certainly if it has a clear mandate. But it must also be clear that the consequences, particularly the financial consequences, of a new direction in Greek policy cannot be transferred to other countries and financed by the taxpayers in these countries.
Germany says it's offered Greece a contingent of 500 German tax collectors to help Athens recover taxes from wealth citizens. The two sides say they've agreed to disagree. Meanwhile, in Athens, thousands of people rallied outside Parliament Thursday in a show of support for the government's anti-austerity campaign. In an address shortly after his own return from a European tour, Prime Minister Alexis Tsipras said Greece will not be bullied by its creditors.
Greek democracy does not take orders, and certainly not through emails. Greece has a clear position. Greece has its own voice. Greece has its own negotiating strength. It is our obligation and duty not to allow our citizens to be deceived once again. We are a sovereign country. We have a democracy. We have a program and an agreement with our people. and we have to honor this agreement.
The European Central Bank has rejected Greece's initial demands for help, tightening rules that'll make it harder for Greek banks to obtain loans. Greece's bailout with European and IMF creditors is due to expire at the end of the month. The International Monetary Fund has granted partial debt relief to the three West African countries worst hit by Ebola. IMF chief Christine Lagarde announced Guinea, Liberia and Sierra Leone will be reprieved of around $100 million in debt payments.
The IMF is giving debt relief to these three countries through the Catastrophe Containment and Relief Trust, which will provide grant aid used to relieve the debt for the next 2 years. I have actually received already from one major donor a commitment to provide additional funding. And I hope that he will not be the only one and that there will be more that will follow suit.
$100 million figure amounts to about a fourth of the total the three countries collectively owe. The joint debt is set to jump to $620 million over the next 3 years because of previously announced loans. In a statement, the group Jubilee Debt Campaign said, quote, grants should be given to cope with the impact of Ebola, not more loans, which leave an unjust debt to be repaid over the next decade. The Obama administration says the recidivism rate of Guantanamo Bay prisoners has fallen since President Obama took office. According to the White House, just six Guantanamo prisoners have engaged in militant activities after their release since 2009, for a rate of under 7%. The comparable rate under President George W. Bush was 19%. But even the lower new rate could be too high. According to Al Jazeera America, there's been only one case of a Guantanamo prisoner turning to militancy after release that can be independently confirmed. The group's CAGE and Center for Constitutional Rights say they know of zero cases. At a Senate hearing this week, Republican Senator Tom Cotton spoke out against President Obama's call to close Guantanamo, saying he believes the prison's only problem is, quote, too many empty cells.
In my opinion, the only problem with Guantanamo Bay is there are too many empty beds and cells there right now. We should be sending more terrorists there for further interrogation to keep this country safe. As far as I'm concerned, every last one of them can rot in hell. But as long as they don't do that, then they can rot in Guantanamo Bay.
Two people are dead after an apparent murder-suicide at the University of South Carolina's School of Public Health. One of the victims was a school professor. The campus was put on lockdown for about an hour on Thursday. Three Democratic lawmakers have announced they'll skip Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu's upcoming speech to Congress on Iran. Congressmembers John Lewis, G.K. Butterfield and Earl Blumenauer say they oppose Netanyahu's visit at a time when Washington seeks a nuclear deal with Iran. The trip has caused a major rift with the White House. On Thursday, House Minority Leader Nancy Pelosi said she hopes the address is canceled, but dismissed talk of a boycott.
I'm seriously considering going. I mean, as I said, as of now, it is my intention to go. It's still my hope that the event will not take place. There's a serious unease, but don't even think in terms of the word boycott. Members will go or they won't go, as they usually go or don't go.
And House Speaker John Boehner has announced another foreign speaker who will address Congress. Pope Francis will become the first ever pope to address a joint session of Congress when he visits the U.S. in September.
On September 24th, His Holiness Pope Francis will visit us here at the United States Capitol. That day, His Holiness will be the first pope in our history to address a joint session of Congress. We're humbled that the Holy Father has accepted our invitation and certainly look forward to receiving his message on behalf of the American people. Okay.
And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman.
And I'm Juan Gonzalez. Welcome to all of our listeners and viewers around the country and around the world. Well, congratulations, Amy, on receiving the 2014 I.F. Stone Medal for Journalistic Independence, a Lifetime Achievement Award from the Nieman Foundation at Harvard University.
Oh, it was really wonderful, Juan, and particularly to be there with Laura Poitras, who also won this I.F. Stone Medal for Journalistic Independence. After we received the awards, we did a kind of talk back last night with Tom Ashbrook of On the Point, and then the high point at dinner was spending time with I.F. Stone's daughter, Celia Gilbert, as well as the director of the famed Vietnam movie Hearts and Minds, Peter Davis. We just had a great time.
Well, it's a well-deserved award.
Thank you. And Juan, you have a cover story in the New York Daily News today.
Yes. Well, I'm reporting in today's Daily News on a new report by the New York City Department of Investigations on something I've been covering now for over 5 years, which is the massive overhaul in the previous Bloomberg administration of the city's vital 911 emergency communication system. And it's a really startling report. It shows that, among other things, the report shows that the project is 10 years behind schedule and has increased by over $1 billion in cost during the period since it began in 2005. The report also finds that the city officials tried to order their employees to sanitize their reports to minimize the problems that the program had. It found that officials also hid about $200 million in additional costs in the projects and the budgets of different city agencies, so no one could really know how much the project was spiraling out of control. And it finds that the private consultants were running amok, basically with very little control, driving up the prices to the city, sometimes as much as markups of 600%. And we're talking about major companies. We're talking about Motorola, Hewlett-Packard, Northrop Grumman, Verizon. These were the companies that were devising this system. And it's another example of what I've been calling one of the biggest scandals in modern government, local and state government, which is these huge technology projects that are supposed to create efficiencies in government, but actually end up as boondoggles. And this is now the latest one. Thankfully, the new de Blasio administration has sent a whole lot of those private consultants packing now and is bringing a lot of the work in-house to have government workers and government managers in charge of it. And we'll see if that makes a big difference in the future. But it's really astonishing report of a decade-long project that went awry. Hmm.
Well, I hope you continue to give us reports like this. And the biggest one you broke was City Time. That was the biggest financial scandal.
Well, actually, this is bigger in money, but in City Time, about a dozen people ended up being indicted. That was a city's payroll system, computerizing the payroll system for 300,000 city workers. And that ended up with a dozen people arrested, and most of them sent to long prison terms as a result of that, because that was outright fraud. This is just rampant mismanagement at this level, not direct fraud.
Well, we'll link to your piece at democracynow.org.
Well, after much anticipation this week, the chair of the Federal Communications Commission unveiled what he calls, quote, the strongest open internet protections ever proposed by the agency. In a blog post published Wednesday on the website of Wired Magazine, FCC Chairman Tom Wheeler backed the regulation of internet service like a public utility to uphold net neutrality, the principle of a free and open internet, noting he used to think that the FCC could assure internet openness through a determination of commercial reasonableness. Wheeler wrote, quote, while a recent court decision seemed to draw a roadmap for using this approach, I became concerned that this relatively new concept might down the road be interpreted to mean what is reasonable for commercial interests, not consumers. That is why I am proposing that the FCC use its Title II authority to implement and enforce open internet protections.
Wheeler's plan will let the agency prevent internet service providers like Comcast from blocking access to websites, slowing down content, or providing paid fast lanes for internet service. It would also extend such protections to internet service on cell phones and tablets. Wheeler discuss the plan on PBS NewsHour.
What we're doing is we're taking the legal construct that once was used for phone companies and paring it back to modernize it so it specifically deals with this issue. So it's not really utility regulation, but it is regulation to make sure that there is somebody watching out for the consumer, that, like you said, there's no paid prioritization, there's no blocking, there's no throttling, and most important, there will be ongoing rules in perpetuity so that there'll be a yardstick to measure what's fair for consumers.
Tom Wheeler, a former lobbyist for the cell phone and cable industries, was not initially expected to take such a strong stand on net neutrality. His proposal comes after the FCC received a record-setting number of comments, nearly 4 million, almost all in support of strong protections. By comparison, Janet Jackson's accidental exposure of her breast during the 2004 Super Bowl triggered 1.4 million comments to the FCC. On Wednesday, Democratic Senator Ed Markey of Massachusetts hailed Wheeler's proposal.
Today is a day where consumers and innovators, entrepreneurs, anyone who counts on the internet to connect to the world is going to now be protected in the 21st century. Reclassifying broadband under Title II is a major victory for our economy, for our consumers, and for free expression of ideas.
The FCC will vote on Wheeler's proposal February 26 ahead of an influx of lobbying by the telecom industry, which has also threatened to sue if the measure passes. For more, we're joined by Tim Carr, Senior Director of Strategy for Free Press. They're one of the main organizers of the Internet Countdown campaign leading up to the FCC's net neutrality vote on February 26. Welcome back to Democracy Now, Tim. So talk about this. Is this a complete turnaround? And talk about the significance. What does it mean to be a—to regulate it? Is it under Title II a public utility?
This is a remarkable victory. It is a true David and Goliath story, except in this instance, there are 4 million Davids who contacted the FCC. There are 100,000 more who've been calling members of Congress. And we've turned conventional wisdom on its ear, where everybody thought at the beginning of the year that the phone and cable lobby would simply write this rule and be done with it. That has changed completely. What Chairman Wheeler has done is proposed Title II protections, which are not public utility protections in the sense where he's focused is on the issue of discrimination. And the reason that they call this new media is it's not like old media. It's not like television. It's not like radio. It's not like newspapers. Those are one-way medias. This is a two-way communications media. And the rule that he has proposed is protects two-way communications. It makes sure that the provider, the carrier of that information, cannot discriminate in any way.
Well, Tim, Verizon released a statement calling FCC Chair Wheeler's proposal counterproductive. It said, quote, the FCC can address any harmful behavior without taking this radical step. And the company warned that heavy regulation of the internet will create uncertainty and chill investment among the many players.
Well, the irony about Verizon is that this whole process began when Verizon sued the FCC. An earlier rule that was insufficient. It didn't use the Title II authority. The FCC lost that lawsuit and is now proposing Title II, which is the proper solution. Now Verizon is claiming that they want to go back to the old system, the one that they sued for. So Verizon has put forth all sorts of arguments. They've said that it will cripple investment, and then their CFO went before investors and said Title II won't affect investment in any way. So you will be hearing this sort of noise from the phone and cable lobby as February 26th approaches. That is the day of the vote. What Wheeler has done is simply announced his intentions via Wired, PBS, and some other outlets, but we don't really know the fine details of the order.
It seems to me one of the interesting things about this in terms of the public response is that we've now seen over the last decade or so numerous major battles occur over the question of media policy and communications policy in the country, usually not covered by the commercial press. Yet, I'm thinking back to 2002 with the whole major media mergers under Chairman Powell during the Bush administration. 2 million people commented to the FCC opposed to it. Now we've had this 4 million people on the issue of net neutrality. So you're seeing this enormous public movement despite the fact that it's not being the commercial media are not paying attention to these major policy battles.
Well, there's an explanation for that. Oftentimes, the commercial media has a stake in the outcomes of these policy fights. So oftentimes, you will find them undercovered. But the public does understand what's at stake here. What's at stake is their ability to connect and communicate without interference from these providers. And it's really This movement for media reform has really picked up steam in the last 5 years. We saw millions of people protesting PIPA and SOPA legislation in 2011. They managed to kill a bill that had very draconian copyright legislation written, rules written into the legislation. And now we're fighting for net neutrality. So what is really happening is that the internet public, is truly a constituency. We are a group of millions of people who come from all different backgrounds who must be dealt with before Congress writes any laws that threaten our rights to connect and communicate.
In November, protesters called on Wheeler to favor net neutrality as they blockaded his driveway when he attempted to go to work.
So, I'm sorry, but we can't let you go to work today because you work for Comcast, Verizon, and AT&T, and not for the people. And so we can't let you go there because you're selling us out on internet neutrality, and that's not okay with us. So we want to know which side you're on, no. Tom.
Which side are you on, Tom? And then back in May, we were in Washington, and we went over to the FCC, and there was an Occupy-like encampment outside of the FCC.
Yes. I mean, the creativity of the grassroots has been really remarkable. There have been events around the country. There have been marches. There was a cat parade recently where you had numerous cats or representations of cats stake out the lawn of the FCC. Cats, of course, are considered the mascot of the open internet. So there has been a sort of million points of pressure against the agency that goes all the way up to the White House. The president in November, of course, sided with net neutrality advocates and said Title II is the way that you solve this problem, is the way that you protect internet users. So this has been a very momentous occasion. We still have 3 weeks left before the vote occurs. After that, Congress will likely get engaged with this. And so while we're very happy today, there's still a lot of work to be done.
I want to ask you about the amazing change in Wheeler's position on this, because, you know, he's, I think, the only person ever elected to both the Cable Industry Hall of Fame and the Telecom Industry Hall of Fame. He was a lobbyist for the industry for many years, and yet he has gradually shifted, even perhaps now promulgating a stronger policy than even President Obama was talking about. Can you talk about that shift? And also, in his statement, he said that his own experience as an initial entrepreneur when he was starting a small company back several decades ago showed him the dangers of the cable industry being gatekeepers to the internet. Could you talk about that?
Well, he can certainly draw from that experience. It's interesting with Chairman Wheeler, because what usually happens at the FCC is that you're a public servant first. And there's this thing called the revolving door, which then spins you out into jobs and industry. The person who's the top lobbyist for the National Cable and Telecommunications Association is a former chairman, Michael Powell, who you probably remember from those fights in 2003. And Wheeler is at the end of his career. He's a very dedicated Obama supporter. He was appointed by the president. He raised money for President Obama's elections, or his campaigns. And so he feels, I think, an allegiance both to Obama. He's received a lot of pressure from the public. We've kind of narrowed his options for him, and he's finally come to a point of realization that Title II is actually the best solution.
And 4 million responses on the FCC website, that's more than any response to any government agency in history.
Yes, this has been a remarkable mobilization, and it's not just groups like Free Press, but there are groups Demand Progress, Fight for the Future, Color of Change, that really cover the political spectrum, that have gone out to their constituents and engaged them in this process. And they're still very engaged. People should really have reason to celebrate today.
Tim Carr, I want to thank you for being with us, Senior Director of Strategy for Free Press, one of the main organizers of the Internet Countdown campaign leading up to the FCC's net neutrality vote on February 26th. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. When we come back, a Democracy Now! Exclusive. A former Florida professor has been deported this week from the United States. We will speak to him in Istanbul, Turkey. Stay with us.
Freedom, 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 freedom.
Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Along the way from my home, yeah, yeah, Lord. Singing freedom, 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 freedom.
Freedom by Richie Havens here on Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez.
The Palestinian activist and professor Sami Al-Aryan has been deported this week from the United States in one of the most controversial prosecutions of the post-9/11 era. Al-Aryan was jailed in Florida for 5.5 years on what many described as trumped-up charges. He was arrested in 2003 at a time when he was one of the most prominent Palestinian activists in the United States. In addition to teaching at the University of South Florida, Al-Aryan was a frequent media commentator and speaker at anti-war rallies. He co-founded the Tampa Bay Coalition for Peace and Justice and the National Coalition to Protect Political Freedom. Between 1997 and 2001, he visited the White House 4 times. He actively campaigned for George W. Bush in the 2000 election. But life for Sami Al-Aryan changed after the September 11th attacks.
On September 28, 2001, Sami Al-Aryan was interviewed on Fox News by Bill O'Reilly about former University of South Florida professor Ramadan Shalla, who went on to become the leader of the militant group Palestinian Islamic Jihad. Beginning the next day, the University of South Florida, where Al-Aryan worked, was overwhelmed by hundreds of threatening letters and emails. 36 hours after the interview, the university put Professor Al-Aryan on paid leave. In October of 2002, I interviewed Professor Al-Aryan here in New York when he spoke at the Not in Our Name rally in Central Park. I asked him about his appearance on Bill O'Reilly.
The way it was, the interview went, the guy attacked me viciously. So many emails and threatening phone calls came to me personally and at the department. So the department put me on paid leave, and then they banned me after that from coming to campus within 3 months because of the, you know, the orchestrated campaign by pro-Zionist groups and also by some politicians and some appointed people, people appointed by Governor Bush, particularly members of the Board of Trustees at the university. They voted to terminate my employment in December of 2001. It hasn't been finalized because faculty unions and other professors from around the country, as well as the American Association of University Professors, have been protesting. And the AAUP has threatened that if they do terminate my employment, they will be censured, which is a black mark. So eventually, the president opted to sue me in court to get me fired through the court system.
So the university has banned you on what grounds?
It's not really clear, except, you know, they say that the campus was disrupted. And it goes like, since people have threatened my life, the campus has not been secure. And the best way to secure it is to terminate my employment. I don't think it's a bogus argument. I don't think it's going to fly. But that's the essence of what they're saying.
So the university is saying because your life has been threatened, they're banning you.
That's right. Exactly. Instead of going against the real terrorists, the perpetrators of the threats, they're going after me.
The Palestinian activist and professor Sami Al-Aryan speaking in October 2002. 4 months after our interview, in February 2003, Al-Aryan was arrested and accused of being a leader of Palestinian Islamic Jihad. The Justice Department handed down a sweeping 50-count indictment against him and 7 other men, charging them with conspiracy to commit murder, giving material support to terrorists, extortion, perjury, and other offenses. He was held in solitary confinement leading up to the trial. This is an excerpt from the documentary USA versus Al-Aryan.
And I was put in solitary confinement 23 hours a day, and sometimes for weeks, 24 hours a day. I wasn't allowed even to see my attorneys when she comes in. I wasn't allowed to call my families. For 6 months, I was not allowed to make a single phone call.
At the end of his trial in December 2005, the jury failed to return a single guilty verdict. Alarian was acquitted on 8 of 17 counts against him, and the jury deadlocked on the rest. 4 months after the verdict, he agreed to plead guilty to one of the remaining charges in exchange for being released and deported. He was later found guilty of civil contempt for refusing to testify before a federal grand jury in another case. In the end, Alarian was jailed from February of 2003 until September of 2008. For 3.5 years, he was imprisoned in solitary confinement. He was then held under house arrest until this week, when he was deported to Turkey. Last year, a federal court dropped all charges against him.
Sami Alarian joins us now from Istanbul, Turkey, in his first broadcast interview since being deported. And we're joined by his daughter, Leyla Alarian, a Peabody Award-winning journalist based in Washington, D.C., co-author with Chris Hedges of the book Collateral Damage, America's War Against Iraqi Civilians. We welcome you both to Democracy Now! Sami Alarian, how does it feel to have left the United States, to have been deported to where you are right now in Turkey?
It feels like I'm free, finally really feeling freedom. For the first time in 12 years, I don't have to watch over my back or over my head or think that someone is trying to monitor you or get you. So it feels like you're free.
And this whole period that you've been under essentially house arrest, could you talk about that experience as well?
I mean, it's much better than prison, of course, but you're under house arrest, so basically you're confined to your living environment. And although there were no restrictions other than that you can't leave the house, you still know that you're being monitored all over you. So it's not really total freedom. And unfortunately, after 9/11, many Americans feel that they live in surveillance and police state, and that's a very discomforting feeling.
Why did you choose to move to Turkey, Sami Alarian?
Well, I actually applied to many countries, some in Latin America, some in the Middle East, and Turkey. And I have friends who actually talked to the Turkish authorities, and they immediately made the decision to accept me. So it's a tribute to them and to their thinking of that they value people who fight for freedom or have been dealt with unjustly, and I'm very grateful for that.
We're also joined by Leyla Alarian, your daughter. Leyla, what's the most important thing for Americans to understand about your father's case and the injustices that occurred here?
I think what's really important to take note of is the fact that when my father was arrested nearly 12 years ago in February—on February 20th, 2003, John Ashcroft went on national television and made pretty extraordinary claims about who my father is, completely distorting and outright lying about my father, calling him a terrorist on national television. And of course, years later, none of that has borne true. My father was acquitted by 12 ordinary jurors in Florida. He said from the very beginning, this is a political case. And I think what people should take away from what has been a nightmare for our family is the fact that in the United States of America, there's no room for political prisoners. There's no room for politically motivated prosecutions. And, you know, my father was vindicated. Even if he did have to eventually leave the country, I think when we look back at this case in history, we'll see that, you know, it's really a shameful part of our history, and, you know, it won't be something that anyone will look at with any kind of pride. So I hope we learn the lessons from this case.
And Leyla, the impact on you and the other members of your family, the many years of this ordeal.
Of course, it's impacted us personally. My sister, the youngest sibling, was 9 years old when all of this began. She's now about to graduate college, so you can just see how long this ordeal has lasted for us. You know, it's been, in many ways, pretty destabilizing, feeling that we've been—not feeling, knowing, actually, that we've been under surveillance even as children. So when we were going over, you know, when my father was preparing for his trial and his attorneys, we learned that, in fact, all of our phone calls were recorded, even as children. We had the opportunity to even listen to some of the phone calls between us and our friends when we were in grade school. It's something that's pretty psychologically jarring and traumatizing. So I think really feeling that every aspect of your life is under surveillance by the government simply because my father was an outspoken Palestinian advocate is something that I'll never truly get over. But at the same time, there's been a lot of positive things that have come out of this case. A lot of the relationships we've formed with many supporters, many activists who've really, you know, shown a tremendous courage in standing up for my father and his rights. And that's what we'll really remember more than anything else.
Sammy, if you could talk from your own perspective about what happened to you. I played that clip from 2002 when I interviewed you at a big peace rally that you were addressing here in New York. You would soon be arrested. Your case factored into a Senate race in Florida. Talk about your journey.
It's really a story of what happened after 9/11. After 9/11, for whatever reason, the forces of intolerance, exclusionary politics, and hegemony really took center stage, where rational people were no longer able to advance any kind of dialogue or rationality in their dealings. So what you have here is people who pressured the government just to take retaliatory action against any activist. And if they had the opportunity to do that, they just went for it. For instance, you know, my case was celebrated as being the first case after the Patriot Act, meaning, you know, they said that the intelligence people did not speak to the prosecutions, and therefore the government to actually prosecute criminals. They didn't know anything about my activities. And that was patently false. Because during my discovery, I saw an earlier version of the indictment back in 2000, when we were very active politically, and my brother-in-law was in immigration court. They really wanted to indict me and stop what, you know, the activity that we're doing. But somehow the Janet Reno Department of Justice refused to prosecute that case. And it was every overact that they said the prosecution didn't know from the intelligence people was there up to 2000. So that was patently false. And it was so political case that, you know, all legal standards were just ignored. You know, my speedy trial, I was denied speedy trial. You know, the judge asked me in April of 2003 if I'm going to waive my speedy trial. When I said no, that meant that they had to try me within 70 days. The government immediately objected and said they were not ready. And if they were not ready to try the case, why did they indict? So if you go back and see the political nature of the case, when USF was in hot water because they wanted to terminate my employment, and they couldn't do it because of the pressure that was coming from all over the place, we found, for instance, that the president of USF went to the U.S. attorney in public asking him to investigate. And at the end of the meeting, the U.S. attorney announces in February of 2002 the impaneling of a grand jury. Now, grand juries are supposed to be in secret. And here we have the university president going to the government, asking them to bail her out. And at the end of the meeting, they announce the impaneling of grand jury. And then nothing happens. And I saw a discovery, for instance, when the government wanted to settle, I mean, sorry, when the university wanted to settle with me, and they offered me almost $1 million to resign, Board of Trustees chairman objected. Because he had been calling me, you know, all kind of names up to that point. And he was the governor's appointee, Jeb Bush's appointee. So he goes to Jeb Bush, basically, and we had that information from their lawyer. And he asks to bail him out. And then somehow, instead of offering me a settlement, they sue me in court in order to fire me. It was a delaying tactic. And I could see during my discovery how the speed up of the grand jury went in August, September, October, and so on, until the indictment came back in February. And then we saw, you know, that during the superseding indictment, when they indicted earlier in 2003, they had 17 counts against me. But they knew that half of these counts, the statute of limitation has run out. And the judge kept telling me, when are you going to supersede? But they didn't want to supersede with less counts. So they added more counts on some transactions that took place in Chicago that I had no knowledge of, and they knew that I had no knowledge of it. And when we went to trial, they produced zero evidence of that. And then the person who was actually on the phone calls, on transactions, on the bank account, on the on everything that had to deal with Chicago was still acquitted, and I wasn't, because the two jurors couldn't bring themselves to acquit in all counts. So from start to finish, it was a political case, unfortunately, that took a very ugly turn. And thankfully, we had great jurors who could see through that, and they would not, at the end, go along and support the government's case.
Sami Alarian, we have to break, but we're going to come back to this discussion. Sami Alarian, prominent Palestinian activist and professor, has lived in the United States for the last 40 years. On Wednesday, was deported to Turkey. He was previously accused of ties to the group Palestinian Islamic Jihad, but a Florida jury failed to return a single guilty verdict on any of the 17 charges against him. We're talking to Sami Alarian in Istanbul, Turkey, and his daughter Leyla, the Peabody Award-winning journalist based in Washington, D.C. We'll continue with them in a moment. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez as we turn to an excerpt of the film USA versus Alarian. Sami Alarian's son, in this excerpt, his son Ali, describes the night his father was arrested in February of 2003.
I woke up because there was a guy just searching all over my room with the flashlight, and he had just, like, I don't remember. He was wearing just, like, all black. So he just starts going like this, like, with the flashlight everywhere. And I guess he just saw me for a second. He just put it on my face, and I wake up, and I look, and the door's already open. And then I was the last one to wake up, so I saw my dad. He was standing where the AC blows. He was standing on the wall with his hands up like this. So then I went to the living room, and I just see all these guys scattered all over the living room, like one police cop and just a million guys in suits. And then I just see my mom and my two sisters crying and everything, and I knew what was going on.
That is Ali Alarian. We're joined by Sami Alarian, who has just been deported to Turkey on Wednesday from the United States after being held in prison for more than 5 years and more than three of those years in solitary confinement, then in house arrest for many years. We're also joined by Sami Alarian's daughter, Leyla Alarian, who is a prominent journalist. She's speaking to us from Washington, D.C. How old were you then, Leyla, when your brother Ali is describing what took place? And where were you when your dad was arrested?
I was actually the same age as my youngest sister is now. I was 21, studying at Georgetown University. And I actually heard the news in a phone call from an administrator who worked in the same office where I had my work-study job. And she called me to convey her sadness over the arrest. I had no idea, so, of course, I was really shocked to learn what happened and, just tried to to focus on graduating, really, at that point. And then after that, I really started becoming involved in advocating for my father and raising awareness, not just about his case, but about the atrocious prison conditions that he was suffering under, which we talked about a little bit earlier. Throughout that time, he also went on three different hunger strikes to protest his prison conditions, but also the fact that, you know, a vindictive prosecutor, long after my father was acquitted by a jury, tried to ensnare him in another case up here in Virginia, unrelated to, even to his own trial. So, you know, there were a number of times when we really had to raise awareness about his case, and that kind of became a full-time job for our family.
And, Sami Alari, the fact that you'd lived in the United States for 40 years and that that you'd had been invited to the White House four times during the Bush years, the impact on you of this sudden turning against you by the government?
Well, of course, I'm aware of the pressures that they were facing, as I said, after 9/11. But unfortunately, you know, most of the rules that that govern the relationship between the citizens and the government were just scrapped. You know, the government has now, or at least shortly after 9/11, they just did whatever they thought they can get away with. You know, I remember one of the lawyers who had access to some information is that even the prosecutors themselves, when they went before indictment to Washington, D.C., telling Chertoff, who was at the time the head of the criminal section of the Justice Department, that some of these charges they couldn't prove. He said everything stays. Everything stays. So, you know, it's very sad that you had to go through this. You know, I you're right. I went to the White House several times, not just during the Bush, but even the Clinton administration. I was able to communicate, and that's tribute to the system, in fact, that I was able to go and meet with all kinds of leaders. You know, I met with Bush, Hillary, Bill Clinton, you know, all kinds of people in Congress, chairmen, speakers, and so on and so forth. And the whole point was to engage politically, because there are certain causes that were of concern to me at the time. A lot of it has to do with civil rights and secret evidence. And I thought that we were making progress, that the politicians were really responsive to our plea and to our campaign against the use of secret evidence. Even in the, a lot of people ask me, why did you support Bush? Well, it wasn't really supporting Bush per se. You know, I approached both the Gore campaign and the Bush campaign. And the Gore campaign, whose administration at the time was using secret evidence against mostly Arabs and Muslims, they just ignored our pleas. While the Bush campaign gave us lip service, except at the last month, when the race was neck to neck. So I get a call from someone who was very close to Karl Rove, asking me personally how we can get the endorsement of the Muslim community. And my answer was that you need to, so he needs to say, the candidate, Bush, needs to say publicly that it's against secret evidence, and that he is for that bill that we were advancing in Congress. And to my surprise, the following day, during the second debate, he said these two things. You know, he was asked about racial profiling, and he came and saying, you know, there's another form of racial profiling used against Arab Americans. It's called secret evidence. I support the bill in Congress. And I get a call back and said, now I delivered. Are you going to deliver? So it shows that empowerment of communities does work when you are active. And the Muslim leaders, the Muslim American leaders actually met and decided to support Bush based on his stand on secret evidence. And the following week, they met and endorsed him, and they identified six states as being the swing states. And Florida was my, because I lived in Florida, it fell into me. And we really did a lot of things for him. Again, based on this, it wasn't based on Iraq or Palestine or other things, it really was based on that one issue. And he won by 537 votes. And obviously, we proved later on that we delivered to him 14,000 extra votes than what he would have got had we not intervened. And then the following month, you know, I get invited to the inauguration, and I get a thank you from Newt Gingrich and John Sununu and Tom Davis that we really delivered that to Bush. And then we asked them to deliver for us secret evidence, you know, the bill against secret evidence. And they tell us that the Bush, because Ashcroft was delayed, his confirmation was delayed, is that it's going to take time to study the issue. But I get a call back in August of 2001, basically telling me from the same person that they've studied the issue and we're going to get to hear good news. And he asked me to invite all the Arab and Muslim leaders to Washington, D.C., at the White House, in which that news would have been announced.
And then what happened? I think it might have our feed to Istanbul, Turkey, might have frozen. But let's see if he came back. Sami, you left us by saying then you got a call where you're supposed to invite everyone to Washington for an important announcement.
Right, and I did invite everybody, and I briefed them, and I told them that there will be an announcement, an important announcement against the use of secret evidence by Bush that afternoon. And everybody was in town. Unfortunately, it was on 9/11. It was 3 o'clock on 9/11. So that meeting never happened. But everybody was asking how come all these Arab and Muslim leaders were in Washington, even though the airspace was closed for several days. And the reason they were behind Bush when he visited the mosque and when he went to the National Cathedral is because they were already there. They were going to meet with him for that announcement.
Wow. And did it ever happen?
It never happened. Of course, you know, at the time we were protesting secret evidence. What happened after 9/11 is that they were arresting people with no evidence. I mean, we really went totally backward. And as I said, all the rules were no longer valid. So, you know, it's a sad story in the history. One day it will be written. But, you know, I'm so happy that a lot of people are pushing back. You know, at the beginning there was this shock where everybody was afraid, everybody was angry, everybody was stepping back. But after the abuses that we've witnessed in the past 10 years, a lot of people are stepping up. A lot of people are protesting. A lot of people are speaking out. We saw even some government contractors or officials like Snowden is crying out against what's taking place. And hopefully, you know, the excesses of the surveillance and police state will be put in place.
Well, this is really an astonishing story. I don't think anyone's actually heard what happened in those days leading up to the September 11th attacks, and that you've told here. But I wanted to ask you: have you noticed any change whatsoever since the Obama administration came in terms of how some of these issues are being handled?
A lot from Obama, but it's all rhetoric. You know, when it comes to actual policies, I haven't seen much change. I mean, at the beginning, give him the benefit of the doubt. You wait for a couple of years. He's busy with the economic program. He's busy with, you know, trying to get elected for the second term. But after 6 years, I haven't really seen much change. And that is very distressing. And I tell people, you know, change should come really from the bottom up. Very rarely you get change from the top down. Until people stand up and speak out and campaign and go to their congressmen and senators and the administration and voice position to these policies that not only is going to affect Arab Americans and Muslim Americans, it's going to affect every American. And we can't advocate a policy where, you know, the rights of the minority could be taken out so that the majority could feel at ease, because eventually Any things that will restrict.
Well, Sami Alarian, we're going to have to leave it there. We seem to have just lost the connection as well. In this exclusive broadcast with Professor Sami Alarian, who has just been deported from the United States after years in jail and then under house arrest, though a Florida jury refused to convict him on any count against him. And I also want to thank Leila Alarian, his daughter, speaking to us from Washington, D.C. That does it for our broadcast. I'll be interviewing Cecile Richards on Wednesday night at the Brooklyn Academy of Music. Check our website at democracynow.org. Democracy Now! Produced by Mike Berkner, Feltz, Armate, Nermin Sheikh, Steve Martinez, Sam Alfa, Connie Massoud, Rabbi Karen, Dina Gesder, Amy Littlefield. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez.